So, good morning everybody, welcome to the next session. So it's my pleasure to introduce Martin Weitz, which will speak about Bose-Einstein condensation of photons and periodic potentials for light.
Okay, first of all, I want to thank the organizers very much for the invitation and also Sandy for agreeing to switch today. As was mentioned, I will speak about a Bose-Einstein condensate of photons and then on some more recent experiments on realizing periodic potentials for the photons. Okay, to begin with, when talking about Bose-Einstein condensation, one mostly thinks of atomic Bose-Einstein condensates in this community. So what you see here is a series of time of flight images of an atomic Bose-Einstein condensate when cooling through the phase transitions at very low temperatures at around 200 nanokelvins. We also carry out experiments in my lab. We also carry out experiments with atomic BECs. There have been, that's not the topic of this talk, there have been, we have a collaboration with the Bilbao Theory Group. We realized in the talk of Enrique Rico, there have been mentioned experiments on ultra-strong coupling of rubidium BEC and an optical lattice. So for that, I refer to his talk. Okay, so for atomic Bose-Einstein condensates, or for atomic gases, the ground state, or more precisely, the state of minimum free energy is the Bose-Einstein condensate. Now, what happens if you're trying to do the same experiment, just cooling down in three dimensions now for photons? What then happens is the following. The photons just go away. It's getting black. Photons normally have no chemical potential. They're not conserved particles. Blackbody radiations at zero Kelvin gives you the absence of photons. So that's not a very interesting state of the light field. So how can you do better? Well, there have been earlier experiments related towards a photon BEC, and the first work that I'm aware of is a proposal for a photon BEC in Compton scattering of a thermal electron gas by Seldovich and Levitch quite long ago, who proposed to scatter photons of electrons in a plasma. And their prediction was what you should get that then get is a thermalized spectrum plus a shockwave structure which resembles a BEC. This was never observed experimentally. What does work experimentally are exciton-polariton condensates, which operate under strong coupling in a semiconductor microcavity. So this is the eigenstates are polaritons, half matter and half light. They're in equilibrium for the condensed part. And well, there's several experiments by Yamamoto, Devredon, Plaideron, Littlewood, and many others. What is more close to our experiment is a proposal for photon fluid in a nonlinear resonator by Ray Chow. So what he wanted to do is thermalize photons by photon-photon scattering, very similar to atom-atom scattering in atomic BEC experiments. Of course, in vacuum, the cross-section for that is basically zero. So his idea was to enhance that by putting an atomic gas. The cross-section nevertheless was too low to obtain thermalization, but I still think this is a very nice idea. Okay, so this is the outline of my talk. I will speak about the Einstein condensate of photons created in an optical microcavity filled with dye molecules. So what we do is we thermalize light by absorption re-emission events on dye molecules. And in the resonator, that's one of the tricks. And the second trick is that we change the dispersion relation from the usual linear for photons to quadratic, that is matter-like, in an optical resonator. I will first talk about the thermodynamics of this state and then on the experiment of Bose-Einstein condensation and then on some more recent experiments on measuring the heat capacity for such a two-dimensional photon gas and on more recent experiments on realizing periodic potentials for the light field to make lattice potentials. Okay, so this is the principle of our experiment. As was mentioned, we use a microresonator to change the photon dispersion. In our case, it's a curved mirror resonator, and the spacing between mirrors is very small. It's an integer times half the wavelengths, and for the sake of simplicity, let's set this integer number n equal to 1. Then it's very clear that very long wave photons do not fit into the micro-resonator. We need a zero of the field here on the mirror surfaces here and here. So there's a maximum wavelength or a minimum frequency of the light to fit inside, and we get a low frequency cutoff, similar as in a microwave waveguide. In our experiment, this is for the TEM00 transverse modes of the n equal to 1 longitudinal manifold, or in this scheme, where it would be for the n equal to 1 longitudinal mode. And on top of that, it's the higher transverse modes. And here at some point, the n equal to 2 longitudinal mode manifold would set in. And the dispersion relation then is not anymore linear as in free space, but we have this low frequency cutoff, and on top of that, the dispersion relation turns out to be quadratic. So next, we thermalize the light by filling dye molecules in liquid solution into our resonator, and we obtain thermal equilibrium by repeated absorption re-emission events on these dye molecules, as I will explain in more detail on the next slides. So these are typical spectra of dye molecules that we use, for example, perylene dimit, and you see here both the absorption and the fluorescence spectrum. You see that the Stokes shift in between, and this can be described by the so-called Kennard-Stefanov theory, which is related to a detailed balance. And this says that the ratio between the frequency-dependent fluorescence divided by the absorption has a Boltzmann-like scaling, e to the minus h bar omega, the photon energy, divided by kBT, the thermal energy. If that is fulfilled, it makes sense that after, that after repeated absorption and re-emission events, you get a thermalized spectrum of the photon gas. And the Bose-Einstein distribution is an asymptotic state of that. This is something that one can show quite easily. But now, what's the background of this Kennard-Stefanov relation? Well, this is my simple model of a dye molecule with an electronic ground state and an electronically excited state. And on top of that, it's all these Rho vibrational states. And now it turns out that about every 10 to minus 14 seconds or so, a solvent molecule collides with the dye. And this is much faster than the upper state electronic lifetime of our dye molecules, which is about a nanosecond or so. So it turns out that due to these fast collisions, we obtain a thermalized distribution, not just within the electronic ground state Rho vibrational manifold, but also within the electronically excited state. And this thermalization then also appears in the spectrum, and then one obtains this Kennard-Stefanov Boltzmann-like scaling between absorption and emission. And now what happens if you absorb a high-frequency photon before it emits, the dye molecule emits? You get a Stokes shift because it relaxes to a lower Rho vibrational level, the Rho vibrational excitation. And after repeated of these Stokes shifts, you normally run out of resonance in free space and the thermalization stops. But within our micro-resonator, we have a low-frequency cutoff and we obtain a thermalized spectrum on top of the low-frequency cutoff. So our model for the photon gas thermalization is that there's subsequent absorption re-emission events on the dye molecules, and while this thermalizes the transversal degrees of freedom of the photon wave vector, the longitudinal wave vector is fixed due to the low-frequency cutoff. So we have not a three-dimensional but a two-dimensional photon gas, and this two-dimensional photon gas is coupled to our dye molecules, which act as a heat path. Okay, the next question is there a photon number variation during the thermalization? In Planck's black body radiation, there's processes like the thermal excitation and the emission of a photon, and this combined process creates a photon. Of course, also the opposite happens, and that destroys a photon, and that's precisely why in a black body radiator, the photons just go away as you cool down. In this new scheme, we have a low frequency cutoff at about 2 electron volts, the energy of a visible directional spectral range photons, and there's quantized electronic levels of the dye. And because of that, thermal excitation is suppressed by a factor e to the minus h bar omega cutoff divided by kBT, which gives you 10 to the minus 6 or so, so a very small number. So that means every time you see an emission of a photon, you basically know for sure that there must have been an absorption event before and during the thermalization, only the energy varies, but not the average number. As a side note, fluctuations around this average value are very well possible because what we are doing during the thermalization, we are converting photons into excited state dye molecules and vice versa. So this, we go back and forth during the thermalization. So there can be fluctuations around the average number, and these fluctuations turn out to be can be very large. It's like the coupling of photons to a reservoir with which not just energy but also number can be exchanged. So it's a grand canonical system, and for grand canonical BC, a G2 of 2 is expected in the condensed state, not 1. Same fluctuations in the or same second order correlations in the condensed state than in the thermal state, and we this actually has been observed experimentally. It's not the topic of this talk, but well, it's in this paper. Okay, so on this next slide, I want to convince you that the trapping of photons in our dye microcavity is formally quite close to atom trapping in atomic BEC experiments. The numbers are completely different, of course. Well, I already told you that we have a quadratic photon dispersion. Next, it turns out that within the microcavity, due to the neural curvature, we also have a trapping potential. The background is that if the photons move to the side, that due to the mirror curvature, the spacing between the mirror surface on the side is smaller than in the center. So to fulfill the boundary conditions, photons have to have a smaller wavelength, that is a higher photon energy if they go to the side. In thermal equilibrium, they're not very happy with that, and they rather remain in the center. And what we do is we imprint a trapping potential to photons. And with that, the system becomes formally equivalent to two-dimensional gas of massive bosons that is harmonically confined. So this is the energy of the photons. The first term here is associated with a frozen longitudinal motion of photons. So that's h bar times omega cutoff, which because this energy is fixed, I can write this in terms of an effective mass times c squared. And the second term, now that's a quadratic term, that's the kinetic energy of photons moving transversely in the resonator plane. And the third term now is from the trapping potential, the trapping potential from the mirror curvature, which turns out to be parabolic for spherically curved mirrors. For such a system, it's known that a BEC exists in thermal equilibrium at a finite temperature. So if there's more particles than a critical particle number, which is pi squared divided by 3 times kbt over h bar omega. Omega is a vibrational frequency squared. And if you put in numbers at room temperature, you arrive at 77,000, which is a reasonable number. So why is that that you can expect to get a BEC at room temperature, whereas for dilute atomic gas, you have to cool down to the microkelvin or nanokelvin regime? Well, the reason is that our effective mass is very small. It's about 2 electron volts, the energy of a visible spectral range photons in mass units, where you arrive at a few times 10 to the minus 36 kilograms, or 10 orders of magnitude smaller than the mass of the rubidium atom. And because of that, the vibrational frequency is high, and we can make this ratio kbt over h bar omega to be a reasonable number, even at room temperature. Okay, so this is how our experimental setup looks like. So this is our dipole microcavity. The spacing between mirrors is not lambda over 2, but 7 times lambda over 2, but that works as well. And we pump with a laser beam at 45 degrees angles about. And the light that leaks out of the microcavity, we analyze spatially with a camera and spectrally with a spectrometer. This is now experimental data. First, here on the left-hand side, you see images of the microcavity emission. This is below the threshold to a BEC, where you see a thermal photon cloud. So that the condensate then shows up as a peak in the center. That's a TM00 mode on top of the thermal cloud. And to look more into details, we look at spectra. So up here, these are theory spectra. These are experimental spectra. So to the left, it's smaller photon wavelengths, that is higher photon energy. So for small photon numbers, we basically see Boltzmann-like distribution above the low frequency cutoff. So here's the low frequency cutoff. And to the left, as I was mentioning, it's higher photon energies. And if you put more photons than the critical photon number, we see a peak at the position of the cutoff that we attribute to the BEC. So this is wider than theory spectrum because of the finite resolution of our spectrometer. So this was published in 2010. There's now two more recent experiments by Rob Nyman at Imperial College and Ries van Oosten at Utrecht, who basically see the same thing. And there's a fourth experiment being built up in Twente by Jan Kleers, who has his own group now. Okay, so now the question, of course, is what is the difference to a laser? Well, basically, a laser is a thermal non-equilibrium state, where the BEC is defined to be in thermal equilibrium. So we wanted to check for this difference experimentally, and what we did is we varied the thermalization. So this is a first data at low thermal contact, which we reached by putting the cutoff frequency relatively far away from the absorption maximum of the dye. So there was few photon dye interactions and few thermal contact. And what we also did is we put the pump laser beam not in the center of the trapping potential, but rather more to the side. The trapping potential, as I was mentioning, that's imprinted by the mirror curvature, to make the initial state further removed from the thermal equilibrium state. And what you see here in the regime of low thermal contact is that photons oscillate back and forth in this trapping potential. So this is a highly, and remain there, this is a highly excited non-equilibrium lasing-like state, in this case, mode-locked lasing state. On the other hand, if we now put the cutoff more close to the absorption maximum of the dye, such that we get thermalization, what you see is that photons thermalize to lower energetic states in the center near the of the trapping potential near the cutoff, and therefore BC. So this is basically about a lasing to condensation crossover. Okay, so what I'm showing you next here is experiments studying calorimetric properties of this two-dimensional photon gas. Our main aim was to measure the heat capacity of the photon gas. Regarding the heat capacity, there have been, what is most known is early work on the heat capacity of liquid helium. There's a famous lambda transition around the phase transition. This phase transition is the heat capacity there shows the famous lambda spike. And it turns out that for cold atoms, this is something that's relatively hard to measure in bosonic systems. There's early experiments by Cornell and Wyman, and more recent experiments here by Baniato from Brazil. There is, with fermion pairs, very nice recent work by the Zwirlein group. Our measurement of the heat capacity looks at the spectra. So these are spectra of the phase transition with an improved grating spectrometer, because, I mean, for light to measure the energy that works of light that works best with a spectrometer. It turns out that we cannot change the temperature of the dye molecules in a very large range, because if we would go too low, the dye would freeze and change its properties, and if it would go too high, it would evaporate. So what we instead do to tune over the phase transition is we vary the photon number. What we do is we first of all determine the internal energy by integrating from the cutoff to lower wavelengths to higher photon energies or smaller wavelengths at a given photon number divided by the critical photon number. And this is equivalent to the temperature divided by the critical temperature square, this two-dimensional harmonically confined system. And this here shows you the internal energy versus T over Tc. The data. And to obtain the heat capacity, we differentiate that. And what we then get is the following. So we get a nice spike separating the thermal gas phase from the BEC phase. So we do see critical behavior. At high relative temperatures, we approach the an asymptotic value of 2 times the Boltzmann constant per particle. And that's precisely what you expect in the classical case, because while you expect an energy of kVt half per degree of freedom, we have two kinetic degrees of freedom and two potential ones in our two-dimensional harmonically confined system. So we expect an energy of 2 times kVt per particle, and the associated heat capacity is 2 times the Boltzmann constant, which is precisely our asymptotic value. Okay, next we can also determine the entropy of the trapped two-dimensional photon gas. The entropy from this data, the entropy is the integral over the heat divided by the temperature, and if you replace the heat by the heat capacity times the temperature, from this was the data that I previously showed you, we get this curve here. Not the curve, but rather the data points, where I, in addition, assumed that the entropy, if you go to zero temperature, approaches zero. The data points agree very well with the theoretical value, which is this black line. I should point out that the heat capacity, of course, is something that can also be measured in atomic systems. There, the usual technique is to use camera images and the local density approximation in several different labs. So basically, we can do the same thing. For our optical quantum gas, we just use different experimental techniques. A spectrometer for light is a very nice tool. Okay, so next, I want to tell. Yes?
So you see 0.5 here, what's the limit there?
If you go too high, at too high photon numbers, so we can see. Go to condensate fractions of something like 85%. If you go too high, we get non-equilibrium. So our thermalizations, the dye molecules, work great for not too large photon numbers. But if you go too large, it's becoming non-equilibrium. So possible, the motivation to study lattice potentials is to study stronger correlated quantum gas as the one insulator transitions for light, to realize artificial magnetic fields and to realize quantum many-body states. There's many proposals and also first experiments in the field of polaritons. What you basically want to do to realize periodic potentials for light is change the optical lengths between mirror surfaces as a function of transversal position. What we do is, in this part of the work that I'm showing you, is not change the physical lengths between mirror surfaces, but only the refractive index as a function of transverse positions. And we do that by heating, so relying on the thermo-optic response, and to increase the thermo on the optic response of our dye solution, we add a thermosensitive polymer solution to our dye. Then if we heat here and here, what happens is what I'm showing you here is the optical lengths versus the transverse positions, and at the positions where we heat, longer wavelength photons, that means lower energetic photons fit between the mirror surfaces. And the experimental apparatus that we use there is shown here. So we use a cavity where one of the cavity mirrors is replaced by a mirror where we added an absorbing silicon layer below the dielectric surface. And what we then do is with a focused laser beam that we steer with a two-dimensional Galvo scanner, we heat at different transverse positions. On the right-hand side, you now see the observed cavity emission for different heat patterns here, and well, basically, we can create different lattices. And the main question now, of course, is: are we still thermalized? Also, can, despite this thermal structuring, we observe thermalization? And what you see here is a spectrum of the light within one of these microsites. What we see is still a thermal spectrum, plus if you go to higher photon numbers, a condensate. So despite this thermal structuring, the spatial structuring, sorry, the thermalization is still faster than the loss. And we get here a photon microcondensate with a critical photon number of 68. I should point out that more recently, Rob Nyman realized microcondensates with a critical number that was even smaller, with a critical photon number of 7, that's published in Nature Physics Online this year, very recently. While what we looked here on the right-hand side is a temporal evolution of the ground mode versus time, and we see a frequency chirp of the emission that we attribute as evidence for thermo-optic delayed thermo-optic interaction. So our main interaction between photons is due to thermo-optic effects. We heat by photons themselves, and this induces an interaction. But the question, of course, is this due to the pump beam, or is this due to the condensate photons themselves? And to check that, we here looked for the increase of the mode diameter versus the pump beam diameter. And while for small pump beam diameters, we have the effect of the pump beam itself, and for large pump beam diameters, increase becomes independent of the size of the pump beam, and this means that it's the condensate photons themselves. So we have a thermo-optic self-interaction during the pump pulse accumulated which corresponds to quite small effective photon self-interaction of 2.5 times 10 to the minus 5. Right, next we study double wells potentials. If we pump one of the sites, we see that there's, after a certain time, tunneling into the next site as soon as this site, due to the thermo-optic interaction, chirps into resonance with the second one. From the width of this tunnel resonance, we can extract the tunnel coupling. And this slide here shows you the tunnel coupling versus distance, and as expected, this increases or decreases exponentially with the distance. Okay, so this photon lattices are sketched much more nicely on this cover images of Nature Photonics of September last year, where this was published. And on this slide, I'm showing you a more recent experiment, the result of more recent experiments. What we did more recently, we studied double well potentials. And what we basically want to do, we want to populate the lower of the lower state of this double well potential, but by thermalization. So if you have a double well potential has two states, if the photons are cold, you expect that they populate only the lower state. If we would do this experiment just with a double well potential, due to the finite site spacing, we would have to cool down to 4 kelvins or so. To be able to do this at room temperature, we are working with the BEC effect. We superimpose this by a harmonic trapping potential, because then we have the right density of states for a BEC. What I'm showing you here is that space versus photon energies, these are the two lower states, and these are the higher states of the harmonic trap. So basically here this is the thermalized spectrum, and there you see that we can get a BEC in the lowest symmetric superposition state. To conclude, we see a BEC of photons, some time ago, we can measure the heat capacity and we can make lattice potentials. In the future, it would be interesting use photon thermalization for the concentration of diffuse sunlight. I would argue that photon Bose-Einstein condensate is a new state of the light field, and it's very interesting to explore that in detail more in future. Some future directions are to look into the grand canonical BEC regime in more detail and to check for superfluidity. So we know it's a BEC, but we do not yet know whether it's a superfluid. It's very interesting to look for quantum many-body states and periodic potentials. And if the ground state is an entangled state with effective photon interactions, the hope is that we can populate that macroscopically by cooling alone. That's something that you cannot do for atomic BECs. There you first have to produce a BEC and then manipulate into the lattice. And we can cool in the presence of lattice potentials. And it also would be interesting to look for topological effects. And finally, it would be nice to get as light sources in U-wavelength regime as coherent UV sources. And finally, I want to thank the members of my group, in particular Christian Kurtscheid and Eric Busley, and of the earlier team, Julian Schmidt and Jan Kleers. And I also want to thank you for listening.
Thank you very much. We have short time for a few questions.
So, Martin, beautiful talk. Can you...